Church of the Ascension. I'm glad you're here this morning. I'll tell you, it continues to be just a fabulous feeling to have my whole family here as we settle into the house and into the neighborhood. We've continued to experience a very warm welcome. I appreciate the welcome that you extended to my dad last week as he preached. You humored him well. He may even come back at some point, I suppose. In fact, a few folks maybe have humored him a little too well. They said to him and to me, they said, maybe we chose the wrong guy. I said, no, he's going back to South Carolina. I did tell one person, well, you can have him. It was a lot of fun. I always enjoy the opportunity to serve together. You know, we were in a family business together for a brief period. We sold groceries together, but we like this family business even better. And it's fun to be able to share stories and share culture with one another as well. So, appreciate that very much. And I realized something in a matter of the sharing of family. You know, so my parents were here, they spent some time with their kids, and then my sister and her family were here, and we had this week together. And we were grateful for the time, we were grateful for the help in unpacking boxes and whatnot. But I also realized, and it's not a new revelation, but it nourishes the soul. It does something for your very being to be together with family. And part of it is that exchange between Dad and I about being clergy and being able to share ideas and that kind of thing. But I think just being together as family nourishes the soul. And they were, unlike the last 10 years where they've had to fly to visit us, they didn't have a hard and fast leave date. And when it came time for them to leave, I found my spirit kind of clinging to the idea that they needed to stay an extra day or two. And part of what I asked them, I said, "Well, I'll see you again this year, won't I?" Which is a new thing. You know, for the past 10 years, we've seen them about once a year. And they said, "Yeah, we're going to be back in Texas around Thanksgiving." I said, "Well, I guess you can leave then, you know." And they said, "Well, all right, you know, we'll see you soon." And it was a very different kind of thing. We realized it nourished my very being, just being together. I knew that from the past, but I longed for that kind of nourishment in the in-between, and I'm grateful that it won't be quite as long in the in-between anymore. I think, in some sense, that's the same kind of nourishment that we find at church. It's the same kind of nourishment that the Gospel of John speaks of when it talks about the bread of life. This Jesus that we share is the nourishment that's good for our soul and for our being, and it fuels us for things and in ways that we don't experience in other ways. Now, when I gathered this right away this morning, when I came in, I said, when two or three are gathered, there we know that God is in the midst of us. And one of the notions, we talk about church and what church can and should be. We talk about what church is at its best. It's a glorification of the kingdom, a sharing of Christ, love, mercy, grace, and it just kind of amplifies all of those things. At its worst, well, maybe we won't talk about that this morning. We're still getting to know each other. But the notion that church exists beyond these walls is very important. And sometimes when we talk about church, when we talk about faith, instead of saying church, I talk about faith community. And what I mean by that is I mean this, but I also mean that we have lots of different faith communities we belong to. It might be a Bible study. That's a community of sorts as you work to nourish one another and support one another in understanding the scriptures, work to break them open, gain new understanding. Hopefully your family unit, both big and small, is a faith community of sorts. You probably pray together as you break bread and nourish your bodies in that way. You work to nourish your souls. You probably spend some amount of time praying together and investigating what one another believes. But I will say, what's really powerful and exciting is, in the bigger context, when we gather like this, in a church setting of more believers, and we gather in a larger community of faith, it's fascinating to see how the power of the gifts of the Spirit work together. Now, before I dive fully into Ephesians, I do want to say the other notion And I think this is what we gain in those smaller circles, and I think it's part of what we long for in our family connections, is sometimes we need to work to address concerns or wrongs among us too. And this passage from Samuel is such a powerful example of that. And I have to at least preach on it briefly. This is kind of like a double header. I noticed that the pews here have pads and that you'd be comfortable, so I'm not too worried about y'all. I think I'll make it through too. But this in Samuel, you know, David has grown to be an incredibly powerful figure. He's only emboldened further by the knowledge that God is with him and working through him and has given him great victory over his enemies and great power and wealth and built a kingdom around him. And he's gained such stature that he's unable to see the wrongs that he's committing. And now when a man like David gains so much power and stature and wealth and worldly things around him, it's hard for somebody to say, hey buddy, you're messing up. And I'm so grateful for Nathan, who he's known for so long and has a rapport that is good enough to allow him to tell this story and hint at what is happening in the situation with David, and then be able to point out to David that it's him. He's the guy that is behaving so poorly. And I think that is something we're called to as a body of faithful. I mean, we don't have to be calling everybody and each other out, but hopefully you have a person or a few people that are close to you in your life that will be bold enough when we are going wrong and departing from the way of God to help draw us back in. Now, enough of that. I'd like to talk to you a little bit about Ephesians and what is addressed there. So Paul is writing the Ephesians. We've been reading through parts of the letter from Paul to the Ephesians for a number of weeks now, and we're in a really exciting part of it. So Paul has been kind of addressing general concerns and how to be a community of faith and believers. And the first part of the passage today talks about being at unity with one another. Now, whether we're talking about the small community of faith, your household of faith, or your larger family, or even a big community of faith, like we have here at Ascension, the reality is there are times where we're at odds with one another. There's times where we don't agree on the way things are supposed to be, whether it's something, could be the way we worship, could be, I've heard sometimes you talk about where we put flags, and different pieces of furniture, and sometimes the answer is like, that's just the wrong way, this is the right way, or this is the way it's always been, and this is, So we get kind of hung up on these things. Well, part of what Paul is encouraging the Ephesians and Christendom in general, those who wish to be a follower of the way that Jesus offers us as a way of life in union with God, is that we need to be at union and in unity with one another. Because if we're not at unity with one another, we're not experiencing the fullness of the gifts of the Spirit, because it's only in partnering together and forming community that we experience those, that fullness. We're at unity with one another, and we can partner with, because we all have different gifts, right? I mean, sometimes offer to share this pulpit with people that, I offer my dad, and he said, yeah. But sometimes when I offer people, tell me you should preach, and they go, no way. And some people have gifts like way Mark leads us in music is incredible. Or we have gifts, people who read or who teach or who evangelize. We need a few more evangelists. I once said, there's the jobs we kind of specialize within our household, we kind of specialize within our community of faith. I said, evangelism is maybe a little like the dishes. Nobody thinks they're good at them, right? You're around and have somebody else, it's like the laundry. And I was like, everybody else, that must be, that's just not my gift, you know? But really, the reality is evangelism, whether we're gifted with evangelism or not, it's something we're all called to do. We all have to participate in from time to time. And part of what's unique about the gifts of the Spirit, we each have different gifts, and we're each, as we come together, those gifts are amplified and kind of just grow and we can help nurture, but we also learn from one another's gifts. So even if, you know, we don't feel particularly gifted in an area, as we partner with somebody else, we might be emboldened to try things that we wouldn't try on our own. We might be emboldened to learn a new approach or a way or a new understanding of Scripture. And so I hope that we will indeed learn from that. And so this passage from Ephesians, it talks a little bit about these different gifts, and it talks a little bit about unity. And I think the really fabulous thing is that when we do find the unity with one another, we partner together with our various gifts of the Spirit, the talents that God has instilled in our very being, that it is then that we are best able to experience the fullness of God. And you may have heard someone say, you know, we're supposed to be Christ-like. If we want to be a disciple, if we want to be a Christian, if we want to live into our baptismal covenant, one of the things we're supposed to be Christ-like. I would suggest to you that more than Christ-like, we as Christians, as those who are working to fulfill their baptismal covenant, as those who want to live into the way of life that's described to us in the Gospels, that we are to be Christ to the world. I don't know about you, but I know that I as an individual am not up to the task of being Christ to the world. I don't have the wherewithal alone to be Christ to the world, but I would suggest to you that when we are in unity with one another, when we are bound together with the Holy Spirit, and we allow each to serve from their gifts, that collectively, my brothers and sisters in Christ, we are Christ to the world. Amen. What better thing would there be than that? So, I urge you, my prayer for us, as we continue the life at Ascension, is that we will continue to investigate our own spiritual gifts, that we will work to cultivate them and we'll work to partner with one another. This year, as we enter the fall, at a time when we often have talks of stewardship, nobody cringed yet, talk about stewardship in the fall, and really stewardship is something that happens every day and every week and every month of our lives. It's what we do with the gifts we've been given, both financial, time, and otherwise. And one of the things we're going to do when we enter that stewardship season, we're particularly deliberate about talking about stewardship, is we're going to actually use a spiritual gifts inventory. And we're going to spend a little bit of time about talking about not just how we are going to employ the financial side of stewardship, but how we're going to use the time and the talent that God has given us. And we're going to work deliberately as a church together to cultivate these Spirit-given gifts, that we might partner together, that we might be united in the Spirit, and that we might together be a powerful example of Christ to the world.
Amen.